Hello all. So now we will be discussing about a very important topic, that is local anesthetics. Now, local anesthetics or LA. Now, what is the definition? Local anesthetic means that these drugs, anesthesia word means reversible loss of sensation. Okay. So anesthesia word means reversible loss of sensation. Local means it is in a particular area. Remember, it will be in a particular area of a peripheral spinal nerve. So this is the complete definition of local anesthetic, that local anesthetics, remember, they act on peripheral spinal nerves, they block them and they will cause reversible loss of sensation in a particular area. Okay. Now the point you have to remember, how local anesthetics, they are different from general anesthetics. Okay. Now remember, local anesthetics, they act on peripheral nervous system. They act on peripheral nervous system. Now suppose this is a brain and this is a spinal cord. Remember, brain and spinal cord, they are known as central nervous system. Okay. And the nerves which arise from spinal cord, they are known as peripheral nervous system. So remember, local anesthetics, they act on peripheral nervous system, while general anesthetics, remember, they act on central nervous system. Okay. So can you tell me that among which of the following will cause loss of consciousness, will promote loss of consciousness, the person will become unconscious? Remember, general anesthetics, they are associated with loss of consciousness. So in general anesthesia, patient will become unconscious, while in local anesthetics, remember, there is no loss of consciousness. The person will remain awake. Okay, so this is the basic difference. So local anesthetics, they act on peripheral nervous system. General anesthetics, they act on central nervous system. In local anesthesia, there is no loss of consciousness. The person will remain awake. While in general anesthesia, the person will become unconscious so that you can perform a major surgery. Now let's see what is the mechanism of action of local anesthetics. The mechanism of action of local anesthetics. Okay, so you have to remember that local anesthetics, they act on peripheral nerves. They act on peripheral nerves, and in peripheral nerves, remember, they block conduction of nerves. So the nerves will not able to function. They block conduction of a nerve. So suppose this is a nerve in peripheral nervous system. This is a cell cyton. This is an axon part. Okay, myelin sheath, and this is the axon part. Now, how do local anesthetics, they produce effect? Suppose this is a local anesthetic. Remember, how a nerve generally conducts. Remember, when nerve becomes conducts, nerve, a peripheral nerve conducts when sodium moves inside. When the sodium moves inside a nerve, remember, this sodium causes depolarization of nerve. The sodium causes depolarization of nerve, and this depolarization causes conduction of impulse. Now let's see how do these local anesthetics, they function. Remember, local anesthetics, they block sodium channel. But let's see how do they block sodium channel. There is a difference. This local anesthetics, remember, first they have to enter into the cell. First, they enter into the cell of nerve, and from inside, remember, they block sodium channel. So they block sodium channel from inside the nerve. It is not from outside. They block sodium channel from inside the nerve. So you have to remember one point, that local anesthetics, they block sodium channel. First point, they enter into the nerve cell. Now remember, to enter into the nerve cell, a local anesthetic has to cross the cell membrane. So it has to cross the cell membrane of a nerve. To remember, to cross the cell membrane of a nerve, a drug must be a lipid soluble. Okay, so a drug must be a lipid soluble. Only a lipid soluble drug can cross cell membrane. So we will come to this point. Now, when it enters into the cell, it blocks sodium channel. It blocks sodium channel. And because of blockage of sodium channel, they reduce conduction. They decrease conduction. Now, you have to remember that how do they block sodium channel? You will write that they block sodium channel in use-dependent fashion. They cause use-dependent sodium channel blockage. Now, what do we mean by the word use-dependent sodium channel blockage? Remember, the sodium channel in a nerve is in three stages. So, let's talk about sodium channel. Suppose this is a channel through which generally sodium enters. So, this is the resting state. Remember, in resting state, the sodium is not conducting. The sodium is not conducting. Now, this sodium channel, remember, it becomes open. This is known as open state. In open state, remember, the sodium channel, sodium enters into the cell. Okay, so in open state, it enters into the cell. Now, after this open state, remember, in this stage only, the sodium conduction stops. The sodium conduction stops, and this is known as inactive state. Inactive state. And slowly, this inactive state comes back to the resting state, where it can be opened again. So, remember, this sodium channel has three states, that is resting state, open state through which during which conduction occurs, and inactive state where conduction stops. Now, remember, local anesthetics, or what do we mean by the word use-dependent blockage? Use-dependent blockage means they block sodium channel in open state. They block sodium channel in open state and they convert this sodium channel into inactive state. Okay? So, use dependent blockage means they block sodium channel in open state and it will prolong. This sodium channel will be converted into inactive state. So, this is what do we mean by the word? Use dependent blockage. Use dependent blockage means they will block sodium channel in open state. And this sodium channel will become inactive. Okay? So this is all about the mechanism of action of local anesthetics. Now let's talk about lipid solubility. So let's talk about certain factors which will modify the action of local anesthetics. Factors determining actions of local anesthetics. Okay? So the first factor is lipid solubility. Now, can we say that if a local anesthetic is lipid soluble, it can easily enter into the cell? And if it can easily enter into a nerve cell, it can easily block sodium channels. So, can we say that if a drug is more lipid soluble, it will require lesser dose to enter into the cell? And if lesser dose is required to enter into the cell, it can block sodium channel in lesser dose. So, remember, lipid solubility is directly proportional to potency of a drug. Potency means the amount of drug which is required to produce an effect. So, if a drug is more lipid soluble, the drug will be more potent. More potent means it will require lesser dose. Second point, it will also be directly proportional to duration of action. Okay? Now, why? Because if local anesthetics enter into the cell, it will not be degraded outside the nerve inside the blood. Remember, local anesthetics, they are degraded in the plasma. If local anesthetic will enter into the cell, it will not be degraded outside the nerve cell. Okay? So, because of this reason, the duration of action increases. Now, the point is, let's see what is the importance of this lipid solubility. Okay? Now, remember, normally, all local anesthetics, they are weakly basic drug. How to identify their pK value? pK is a pH corresponds to pH. It is around 8 to 9. Okay. Now, remember, in this local anesthetics, we add sodium bicarbonate. With local anesthetics, we generally add sodium bicarbonate. Now, sodium bicarbonate again is a basic molecule and it is a strongly basic molecule. Now, remember, if you add a basic substance into a weak base, these local anesthetics, remember, basic substance in a more basic media will convert into more lipid soluble. Okay? More lipid soluble. So remember, weak basic drugs in a basic media becomes more lipid soluble. And because of this reason, as it becomes more lipid soluble, can we say that addition of sodium bicarbonate into local anesthetic will increase the potency? Now, lesser duration of local anesthetic will require. It can easily enter into the cell. It will increase the duration of action. And also remember, it will decrease pain at injection site. It will decrease pain at injection site. So addition of sodium bicarbonate to local anesthetic converts local anesthetic into more lipid soluble molecule. Okay. So because of this reason, the potency, duration and the pain at injection site modifies. Potency and duration increases, pain at injection site is reduced. But remember, there is one local anesthetic in which we don't add sodium bicarbonate. Remember, bicarbonate is not added. It is not added to a local anesthetic known as bupivacaine. We don't add bicarbonate to bupivacaine because bupivacaine forms insoluble precipitate in bicarbonate. So it will not able to dissolve properly and we cannot give an injection. So we cannot give bupivacaine because bupivacaine is insoluble in bicarbonate. Okay. Now the second factor we will write is addition. So it was the addition of bicarbonate. Now the second factor is addition of vasoconstrictor. Addition of vasoconstrictor. Okay, now why we add a vasoconstrictor along with to local anesthetic? The reason is we add vasoconstrictor to local anesthetic to reduce systemic absorption. To reduce systemic absorption so that this local anesthetic will remain there and it should not come into the blood. And it should not come into the blood. If it will come into the blood, it will become degraded. And hence to increase the duration of action. Hence to increase the duration of action. Okay. And local vasoconstrictor, remember, as it produces vasoconstriction, it also reduces bleeding. It also reduces bleeding. So it will give us a bloodless field to work on. Okay. So these are the three rationale or principles of adding a vasoconstrictor to a local anesthetic. So to reduce the systemic absorption of local anesthetic, to increase the duration of action of local anesthetic and to reduce bleeding. Now, which vasoconstrictor generally we add? The drug of choice as a local anesthetic we add as a vasoconstrictor we add to local anesthetic is epinephrine. Okay, epinephrine. Epinephrine is also known as adrenaline. We add adrenaline. You can also add one more sympathetic drug, that is phenylephrine. Okay, phenylephrine. So these two drugs are sympathetic drug. Okay. Now there is one more drug which you can add is felipresin. Now, felipresin, as the word presin word is coming, it's a synthetic vasopressin. And all these drugs are vasoconstrictors. And remember, the drug of choice to add is generally epinephrine. Now, what is the concentration of epinephrine we generally use as an addition to local anesthetic? We add a very diluted form. Remember, we add a very diluted form of epinephrine. The dose is around 1:50,000 to 1:3 lakhs. So this is the range depending upon the type of surgery. Remember, the most commonly used epinephrine dose is around 1:2 lakhs. We use 1:2 lakhs. 1:2 lakhs is also equal to 5 microgram per ml. 1:2 lakh is equal to 5 microgram per ml. So it depends upon the surgery. Most commonly used is 1:2 lakhs of epinephrine. Okay. Now just remember that there are certain contraindications to epinephrine. In certain conditions, we don't add epinephrine to local anesthetic. There are certain contraindications in which epinephrine should not be added to local anesthetics. So we will write those conditions. So we will write a mnemonic, Meetha. Okay. The first is, epinephrine is contraindicated in patients of MI. MI means myocardial infarction, because epinephrine can provoke MI. Okay. Epinephrine should not be given in intravenous regional anesthesia. Intravenous regional anesthesia, in this condition, we give local anesthetic IV. And remember, we never give intravenous injections of epinephrine along with local anesthetics. Okay. Any tip surgery. Tip surgery is also known as end artery surgery. Remember, if we are doing any tip surgery or end artery surgery, there is no arteriovenous anastomosis. It can lead to prolonged vasoconstriction. Due to prolonged vasoconstriction, it can lead to gangrene of that area, necrosis or gangrene of an area. Okay. So let's write certain surgeries in which there is no anastomosis, or the tip surgery like digital block or digital surgery, finger surgery. Okay, for fingers, penile surgery, pinna surgery. Okay, nose tip surgery, nose tip surgery. Okay, so in all these surgeries, remember, we don't give epinephrine or any vasoconstrictor, we just give local anesthetic. Epinephrine is absolutely contraindicated in patients of hypertension, and it is contraindicated in patients of arrhythmias. Okay, because it can provoke, itself can provoke arrhythmias in heart. Okay, arrhythmias. So these are the contraindications of using epinephrine to local anesthetic. Now there is one advantage of a drug known as felipressin. Now felipressin, remember, does not act on heart, no action on heart. Hence, felipressin is safe in cases of MI and arrhythmia patient. Okay, felipressin can be given in MI and arrhythmia patient. It does not have action on heart, it is a vasopressin. Okay, now the last point with this vasoconstrictor is, there was one local anesthetic known as cocaine. Okay. Now, cocaine is an LA, local anesthetic, and itself has vasoconstrictor property. It itself has vasoconstrictor property. So, which local anesthetic itself can produce vasoconstriction? That is cocaine, because cocaine increases sympathetic nervous system activity. It increases the release of epinephrine and norepinephrine inside the body. So which local anesthetic itself own can produce vasoconstriction? That is cocaine. So cocaine is a local anesthetic with vasoconstricting property. Okay, now the next part, the third part factor of local anesthetic is roots of LA. Now roots of LA, local anesthetic, we will be discussing in great detail in the end of this section. But remember, the fastest route of action of local anesthetic is subarachnoid. So the fastest action of local anesthetic is subarachnoid block. In subarachnoid block, we inject local anesthetic into CSF. And slowest action of local anesthetic comes in brachial plexus block. Okay? Brachial plexus block, slowest action. So roots we will be discussing in the end section of this chapter. Okay. Now, the fourth point is the toxicity of LA. The toxicity of local anesthetic is common with. So there are certain conditions in which the toxicity of local anesthetic becomes very common. The first condition is hypoxia. Because remember, hypoxia itself can reduce the nerve conduction. Okay? Hypercapnia. Hypercapnia means increase in CO2. Okay? So can we write that this condition as respiratory depression? Because if there is hypoxia and hypercapnia, there is already reduce in nerve conduction. We will write halothane or GA. GA stand for general anesthetic. Remember, general anesthetics also block the conduction of peripheral nerves as their side effect. Okay? Old age. In old age, there is already reduced, there is increased sensitivity. You'll write old age and pregnancy. Remember, in old age and pregnancy, there is increase in sensitivity to local anesthetics. Okay? The reason I will be telling you shortly that in pregnancy, there is a hormone known as progesterone. Progesterone increases the sensitivity of local anesthetics. Okay? So this is about the factors which affect the toxicity of local anesthetics. So toxicity increases in all these conditions. Okay? Now, let's see the effects of LA. Effects of local anesthetics on different nerves. On different nerves. That local anesthetic will affect which peripheral nerve first. This condition is also known as differential blockage. Differential blockage of nerve fibers. Remember, there are different types of nerve fibers in the body, and all nerve fibers respond to local anesthetic in different way. Okay? They all respond to nerve fibers in a different way. So you will write certain rules out here. The rule says, remember that which fibers are more susceptible to the action of local anesthetic. So the first point you will write is, remember, autonomic nerve fibers or autonomic nerves is more susceptible as compared to somatic nerves. Okay, so local anesthetic act more easily on autonomic nerves, and among somatic nerves, you will write it is more of a sensory than motor. Okay, motor nerves. So can we say that maximum is by autonomic, second is sensory, third is motor. Second, we will write, remember, non-myelinated fibers are more susceptible as compared to myelinated fibers. The reason is, in myelinated fibers, in non-myelinated fibers, the number of sodium channels are very less. They can easily be blocked by local anesthetics. And lastly, small fibers, small diameter fibers are more susceptible to large diameter fibers. Okay? Large diameter fibers. You know that large diameter fibers are C fibers, small diameter fibers are A fibers. Okay? So keeping this thing in mind, now let's make a summary that which nerve fibers will be more sensitive. So we will write about the order of sensitivity. We will write order of sensitivity to local anesthetic. Now the order of sensitivity to local anesthetic about the nerve fibers are, remember, there are three types of nerve fibers, A, B, and C. Remember, A are most sensitive to local anesthetic, followed by B, B nerve fibers, followed by C nerve fibers. Okay? So the most sensitive to local anesthetic is A, followed by B, followed by C. Now remember, B is also known as preganglionic sympathetic fibers. Okay, and C, remember, they control temperature. They carry the sensation of temperature. So can we say that temperature is the last sensation to be affected by local anesthetic? So temperature is the least affected sensation to local anesthetic. Now if you talk about A fibers are of different type. So A fibers could be A gamma, A delta, A beta and A alpha. And remember, the most susceptible fibers are A gamma, then A delta, then A beta, A alpha, followed by B, followed by C. Okay, so the most susceptible fibers are A gamma. Now A gamma, remember, they carry muscle tone, they maintain muscle tone. A delta, they carry the sensation of pinprick. A beta, they carry the sensation of touch. And A alpha are motor fibers. They are not sensory fibers, they are motor fibers. So the most susceptible fiber is A gamma, which carry muscle tone. Okay, so this is the order of sensitivity to local anesthetic, that is A, B and C. But remember, in hypoxia, if there is hypoxia, the order of sensitivity changes. The order of sensitivity changes. In hypoxia, the order of sensitivity becomes B, A and C. Okay? In hypoxia, the order of sensitivity becomes B and C. Preganglionic are the most susceptible fiber if there is already hypoxia inside the cell. Okay? Now, let's see what are the drugs we have among LA. Let's see the drugs among local anesthetics now. Okay? Local anesthetic drugs. To understand the drug, first you need to remember the structure of local anesthetic. Okay? Now remember, this local anesthetic, it has two groups. One is amine terminal. This is amine terminal. And this amine terminal is linked to an aromatic ring. This is an aromatic ring. Okay? This is aromatic ring. Now, remember, this amine terminal is water soluble. Water soluble is hydrophilic. And this aromatic ring, remember, is fat soluble or water insoluble, known as hydrophobic region. And remember how they are linked. The link among this amine terminal or this aromatic ring could be either an ester bond, or it could be an amide bond. Okay, so this bond or linkage between these two rings could be an ester or it could be an amide. Depending upon this ester or amide, local anesthetics are divided into two types. So let's talk about types of local anesthetics. So local anesthetics are of two types. They are either ester containing local anesthetic, or they could be amide containing local anesthetics. Okay, depending upon this bond. But remember, this hydrophobic region or aromatic ring, it has local anesthetic property. It has local anesthetic property. That means that this ring, it blocks sodium channel. This ring blocks sodium channel. Okay, so this is this ring which blocks the sodium channel. Okay, so local anesthetic could be of esters or it could be amide. So let's write their names. How to remember their names? Remember, ester containing local anesthetic, how to remember? They contain only one I. They contain only one I. While amide, you are seeing in amide already there is one I. So you will just add, it will contain two I. So in their name, they will have two I word. Okay. So in amide, there will be two I. In esters, there will be one I. So keeping this thing in mind, let's write their names. Among ester containing, we will write the first local anesthetic which we made was cocaine. Okay. We will write other drug, CPC, TB. So P stand for procaine. Then we will write chlorprocaine, chlorprocaine, tetracaine, and benzocaine. And benzocaine. As you can see, only one I is there. Okay? One I is there. Now, among amide containing, we will write the mnemonic. We will write the mnemonic Lampard. Lamp leopard. Okay. L for lignocaine, a very famous drug. We will write articaine. M for mepivacaine. B for bupivacaine, a very important drug again. P for prilocaine. E for etidocaine. R for ropivacaine. And lastly, D for dubucaine. So this is the complete list of amide containing local anesthetic. But you should not get confused. Remember, lignocaine has two more names. It is also known as lidocaine. Again, two I word is coming. The third name of lignocaine is xylocaine. Now what you have to remember, this third name of lignocaine, xylocaine, it has only one I. So this is an exception. Only one I is present in this another name of lignocaine. Okay. So this is the complete list of the drugs among ester containing and amide containing. Okay. Ester containing and amide containing. So this list, first you must remember, it's a very important list. And we will be discussing each of these drugs in great detail. Now let's see what is the difference between we have among ester containing and amide containing. Okay. Now if you talk about esters and amides, ester containing drugs, remember, they are short acting drugs, while amide containing drugs, they are long acting drugs. Okay. Now why they are short acting drug? Because ester containing drugs, they are degraded very rapidly. They are degraded very rapidly in our blood only, in our plasma only, by an enzyme esterases. They are degraded in our blood only by plasma enzymes esterases. Now why these amide containing are very long acting? Because they are degraded very slowly in L for lung, L for liver by CYP450 enzyme. CYP stands for cytochrome P450 enzyme. So that is why ester containings are short acting and amide containings are long acting. Okay. So keeping this thing in mind, we will write that the shortest acting local anesthetic is chlorprocaine, which is an ester containing drug. And amide containing, so this chlorprocaine overall is the shortest. Okay. And among amide containing, the longest acting drug is dubucaine. The longest acting is dubucaine, shortest acting is chlorprocaine. Okay. Now you have to remember that there is an exception out here. Except cocaine. Except cocaine, remember cocaine is degraded in the liver. Remember, cocaine is degraded in the liver by an enzyme esterases in the liver. Cocaine is degraded in liver by esterases enzyme. So esterases enzymes are also present in the liver. So which of the ester containing local anesthetic is degraded in the liver, not in the plasma? That is cocaine. And there is also an exception out here in cases of amide containing. That drug is articaine. Remember, articaine is an amide containing local anesthetic which is degraded by plasma esterases. Articaine is the amide containing local anesthetic which is degraded in the plasma by local anesthetic. So can we say that esters containing LA are shorter acting as compared to amide containing? Amide containing local anesthetics are longer acting. Okay. Because they are degraded in the blood by plasma esterases. But you have to remember one point, that plasma esterase enzyme is absent in CSF. It is absent in CSF. Hence, this esture containing local anesthetics, this esture containing local anesthetic will become long acting. They will become long acting in cases of spinal anesthesia. So normally, esture containing local anesthetics are very short acting drug, but they become long acting in spinal anesthesia because in spinal fluid or CSF, plasma esterases enzyme is absent, which will not able to degrade this esture containing local anesthetics. Okay, so this was the first point of difference between ester containing and abide containing. Now the second point difference we will write, that ester containing, as we know, they are degraded outside the liver, hence they are safe in liver failure. Ester containings, they are safe in liver failure because they are degraded outside the liver, while amide containing, remember, they are contraindicated in liver failure. They are unsafe in liver failure, and because if liver is failed, they will not be able to degrade in the body. Remember, they have less plasma protein binding because they are degraded in the plasma. So they have less plasma protein binding. Amide containing, they are more plasma protein bound. They are more plasma protein bound. And as we know that they are basic drug, remember, basic drugs, they bind to an acidic plasma protein. They are bound to a plasma protein known as alpha 1 acid glycoprotein. So local anesthetics, they bind to which plasma protein? Mainly that is alpha 1 acid glycoprotein, because alpha 1 acid glycoprotein is an acidic plasma protein. It is an acidic plasma protein, and all basic drugs, they bind to them. So basic drugs like local anesthetics, they bind to an acidic plasma protein, alpha 1 acid glycoprotein. And the last point is that this ester containing local anesthetic, they cause severe hypersensitivity. They cause severe allergic reaction. While amide containing, they cause very low hypersensitivity. Very rarely they cause allergic reactions. Okay. So ester containing, they cause severe allergic reaction. Because of all these features, remember, among all these local anesthetics, remember, amide containing local anesthetics are more preferred. They are more preferred over ester containing. Amide containing local anesthetics are more preferred over ester containing local anesthetic. So if we can make a summary, that why amide containing are more preferred, because they are longer acting. They are less toxic or less allergic reaction. And lastly, they cause more, they produce more pain relief. They have more pain relief, or they can produce more analgesia. These are the three reasons why amide containing local anesthetics are preferred over ester containing. They are longer acting, they are less toxic, they cause more pain relief, they have more analgesic property. Okay. So keeping this thing in mind, let's start with now individual drugs. Let's talk about individual drugs among local anesthetics. So let's start with the first one, ester containing. Esters containing local anesthetic. And we will write the first drug among ester containing local anesthetic is cocaine. We will write cocaine. Okay. Now remember, cocaine was the first local anesthetic to be discovered. It was the first local anesthetic, and it was obtained, and it has a natural origin, that it was obtained from nature. It was obtained from the leaves of plant known as erythroxylon coca. It was obtained from a plant of erythroxylon coca by a scientist known as Albert Niemann. Okay. And its clinical use, first of all, its clinical use as a local anesthetic, it was used as an ocular local anesthetic. That means it was given for eye surgeries. It was given as a topical drug for eye surgery. And it was first of all used by a scientist who demonstrated its clinical use, that was Karl Kohler. The scientist who first of all used this local anesthetic was Karl Kohler, and it was obtained by Albert Niemann. Okay. Now, what is the special property of cocaine we know? Remember, cocaine is the only local anesthetics which has sympathomimetic activity. Which has sympathomimetic activity. It means that this local anesthetic cocaine, remember, it increases the level of catecholamines like epinephrine, norepinephrine, and dopamine. Now, how it increases sympathomimetic activity? That suppose this is a nerve, sympathetic nerve, and this sympathetic nerve suppose have released norepinephrine or dopamine or any other chemical, and it act on other neuron. Now remember, the action of norepinephrine is terminated by a process known as reuptake. After its action, this norepinephrine is reuptaken back by the same sympathetic neuron. Remember, cocaine, it inhibits the reuptake of catecholamines. So why, how it increases epinephrine, norepinephrine and dopamine level? By inhibiting reuptake. Reuptake, remember, terminates the action of epinephrine, norepinephrine. So it inhibits reuptake. Because of this reason, the level of norepinephrine or catecholamine remain high, which increases sympathetic activity. Now, it can increase sympathetic activity, remember, both in periphery. It can increase this epinephrine, norepinephrine and dopamine level in periphery as well as central nervous system. Okay, in both cases, the sympathetic activity will increase. Now, in periphery, when sympathetic activity will increase, remember, this norepinephrine, epinephrine, it produces vasoconstriction. It produces vasoconstriction. So, can we say that cocaine is a local anesthetic which itself can produce vasoconstriction? Okay. Now, what about CNS? Remember, when in CNS, the level of dopamine and norepinephrine increases, this increase in level of dopamine and norepinephrine causes addiction. It causes addiction or abuse. So, because of this reason, cocaine is a highly addictive substance. Because it increases the level of norepinephrine, dopamine or catecholamines in the brain. Okay. So, if you talk about the uses, remember, cocaine is only given topically. It is only given topically as a local anesthetic. Remember, it has been now banned as an injection drug. It has been banned now as an injection drug. The reason is because of its highly addictive potential. Because of its highly addictive potential, and because of its vasoconstrictive property, it may cause tissue damage. It may cause tissue damage. So why cocaine has been banned as an injection? Because of its highly addictive substance and it causes tissue damage. Hence, it is only given topically drug. So where it is used? Remember, it is given as a 1 to 10% topical cream for ocular surgery or eye surgeries. So it is given during ocular surgery or in eye surgery. Okay, the only use. Now, if you talk about cocaine abuse, as we know that cocaine is a highly addictive substance. So let's talk about a topic known as cocaine abuse. So cocaine is a drug of abuse, and generally the drug addict, how do they take this cocaine? Remember, they take this cocaine IV. They take this cocaine as a smoke with cigarettes, and they also insufflate or inhale the dry powder form of cocaine. Okay, insufflate the dry powder form. Okay, dry powder form. Now, what is the treatment of cocaine abuse? Remember, the drug of choice for the treatment of cocaine abuse is topiramate. Topiramate, or you will write baclofen. They are anti-epileptic drug. Remember, they are the drug of choice to maintain de-addiction. Okay? Or to prevent withdrawal. You can also use modafinil. Modafinil is given to decrease the euphoric effect of cocaine. To decrease the euphoric or very high feeling or happy feeling comes with cocaine. To reduce this euphoric effect, we give modafinil. Okay. Now there is a one peculiar point with cocaine abuses. Remember, in cocaine, there is no development of tolerance. Okay. Remember, in drug abuse, tolerance is a hallmark. With time, the effect of a drug reduces. With cocaine, there is no development of tolerance. There is no reduction of effect of cocaine in long term. Rather, there is reverse tolerance. Reverse tolerance means if a patient person takes cocaine in a long term basis, now the effect will be produced in a slightest dose or lesser dose. Okay, so reverse tolerance means there will be increase in effect of cocaine when cocaine is taken on regular basis. So it's a very peculiar point about cocaine abuse. Okay, now the last point is, remember, cocaine is absolutely contraindicated in pregnancy. Why? Because it is teratogenic to fetus. Okay, the fetus which will be born is known as cocaine baby. Cocaine baby is also known as crack baby, because cocaine, in common name used by the smuggler, it is also known as cocaine crack. So what is there? There is microcephaly and growth retardation. There is limb atrophy. And there is facial defects. So remember, cocaine is absolutely contraindicated during pregnancy. So now cocaine is very less used because of its addictive potential. Let's talk about now the second drug, that is procaine. Now procaine was the first synthetic local anesthetic to be made. Okay. Now remember, it is used where procaine is used. It is the drug of choice as a local anesthetic in a condition known as malignant hyperthermia. Remember, all local anesthetic can produce a dangerous side effect known as malignant hyperthermia, except procaine. Normally, the most commonly used local anesthetic is lignocaine. Remember, lignocaine is absolutely contraindicated in malignant hyperthermia. Hence, the answer is procaine. Okay. Now, any other use of procaine? Yes. Remember, procaine is also added to. Penicillin G. And it will form procaine penicillin. Now, this procaine penicillin, remember, is a long-acting penicillin. Itself, penicillin G was a short-acting penicillin. So why we attach procaine group to penicillin G? To make it long-acting. And this procaine penicillin is used in the treatment of neurosyphilis. Okay. Now let's talk about the side effects of procaine. Now, remember, procaine, when it gets metabolized in the body, it gets converted into PABA. PABA stands for para amino benzoic acid. So the level of PABA increases. Now this PABA can be taken up by the bacteria, and this PABA can be converted into folic acid. So PABA can be converted into folic acid. So can we say it can increase bacterial growth? Now there is a drug which generally inhibit this action of PABA. The drug which inhibit the conversion of PABA into folic acid, that is sulfonamide. Normally, sulfonamide inhibit the conversion of PABA into folic acid, and procaine, can we say it will increase the conversion of PABA into folic acid? Remember, procaine reduce the effects of antimicrobial known as sulfonamide. Because sulfonamide inhibit PABA, sulfonamide generally inhibit PABA. While procaine is increasing the level of PABA, they are acting in an opposite fashion. So, procaine reduce the effect of an antimicrobial, that is sulfonamide. Okay. Now, let's come to the third drug, that is chlorprocaine. Chlorprocaine. Now, chlorprocaine overall is the shortest and least potent. Least potent means it requires highest dose. It is the shortest and least potent local anesthetic. Okay. But if you talk about the longest means and most potent means which require least dose. The longest and the most potent local anesthetic is Dubocaine. Okay. So the shortest and the least potent local anesthetic is chlorprocaine. The longest and the most potent local anesthetic is Dubocaine. Now, where this chlorprocaine is used, now chlorprocaine, remember, it can be given as a topical LA. It can be given as a topical LA. Now, remember, chlorprocaine is absolutely contraindicated as a, is absolutely contraindicated as a spinal anesthetic. It is absolutely contraindicated as a spinal anesthetic. Remember, it is never given into CSF. The reason is why? Because this chlorprocaine, it contains a molecule known as sodium meta bisulfite. Now, this sodium meta bisulfite is a preservative in chlorprocaine. Now, this sodium meta bisulfite, which is a preservative in chlorprocaine, is a highly neurotoxic molecule. It damages neurons. As it is a highly neurotoxic molecule, because of this reason, it is never given as a spinal injection because of the presence of sodium metabisulfite, which is a preservative in chlorprocaine. Okay. Now, the fourth drug we will write is tetracaine. Okay. Tetracaine. Remember, another names of tetracaine are amethocaine, or it is also known as pontocaine. It is also known as pontocaine. Now, tetracaine, remember, it's a longer acting drug. As compared to chlorprocaine, it is longer acting. Okay. And it is also a slow acting drug. Okay. Now, as it is a longer acting drug, remember, it can be given topically. Topical LA in ENT for ear, nose and throat. When we need local anesthetics in ear, nose and throat, it is also given as a spinal anesthesia. Okay, it is also given as a spinal anesthesia. Now remember, it is not given as an intravenous regional anesthesia. So, it should not be given as an intravenous drug because of its toxicity. And the last drug among ester containing we will write is benzocaine. The last drug is benzocaine. Now, benzocaine is a drug of choice which can be applied on cut surface. It can be applied on the cut surface. Because even if it is applied on skin, on a cut surface, it is not absorbed into the blood. It is not absorbed systemically. So, among cut surface, the drug you will attach is, give is benzocaine. So, benzocaine is the local anesthetic which is applied on cut surfaces. Okay? Because it is not absorbed into the circulation or into the blood. Now, let's come to amide containing local anesthetics. तो अमाइड कंटेनिंग लोकल एनेस्थेटिक्स. एंड अमंग अमाइड कंटेनिंग लोकल एनेस्थेटिक वी विल राइट द हेडिंग फर्स्ट ड्रग इज लिग्नोकेन. फर्स्ट ड्रग इज लिग्नोकेन. नाउ रिमेंबर लिग्नोकेन इज ऑल्सो नोन एज लाइडोकेन. इट इज ऑल्सो नोन एज जाइलोकेन. ओके नाउ लेट्स टॉक अबाउट लिग्नोकेन. रिमेंबर दिस लिग्नोकेन इज अ प्रोटोटाइप ड्रग. प्रोटोटाइप ड्रग मीन्स दैट इट इज द मेन ड्रग एंड वी कंपेयर ऑल अदर ड्रग्स विद लिग्नोकेन. सो द मेन ड्रग अमंग एनेस्थेटिक्स वी हैव इज लिग्नोकेन. एंड दिस लिग्नोकेन इज ऑल्सो नोन एज ऑल पर्पस लोकल एनेस्थेटिक. It is also known as all-purpose local anesthetic. Why? Because it is used everywhere. So, lignocaine is used everywhere. That is why it is known as all-purpose local anesthetic agent. So, keeping this thing in mind, let's see the first uses of lignocaine. Let's see first the uses of lignocaine. The first use of lignocaine we will write is as a topical drug. Okay, so it is given topically on skin and mucous membrane. What type of formulations we have which is applied on topical surfaces? We will write a mnemonic, SOJAS. Okay, it is given as a solution. It is also given as an ointment. It can be given as a jelly. It can be given as an aerosols. And lastly, suppositories. Okay. Now, as a solution, the strength is 2 to 4%. Ointment, 2.5 to 5%. Jelly, 2%. Aerosols, 10%. And suppository, 10%. Okay. Suppository, 10%. Okay. So, remember this part. Now let's see certain examples where it is used as a jelly. Remember, lignocaine is drug of choice during a procedure known as proctoscopy. Proctoscopy. Okay. As an ointment, you can give in dental procedures or dental surgeries. Okay. Dental surgeries. Okay. So there are various conditions in which lignocaines are used. Now let's talk about the second use. It is also given as an epidural injection. It is also given as a spinal anesthesia. So epidural anesthesia, spinal anesthesia. We will be discussing what do we mean by epidural spinal anesthesia shortly. We will write nerve block. And lastly, you will write, it is also given as intravenous. Intravenous regional anesthesia. Intravenous regional anesthesia is also known as IVRA, short form, and it is also known as Beer's block. Intravenous regional anesthesia is also known as Beer's block, and in all of them, lignocaine is the drug of choice. Everywhere, lignocaine is the drug of choice. Now, in epidural analgesia, the strength we give is 1 to 2%. Spinal anesthesia 1.5 to 5%, nerve block 1 to 2%, and intravenously very less dose is given, 0.5%. Okay, so this is the strength of lignocaine we use in various conditions. Okay, so this is the strength we give. So topical, epidural, spinal, nerve block, intravenous, regional anesthesia. Okay, now let's see one drawback of lignocaine. Okay. Let's see. Now remember, lignocaine, remember, cannot penetrate intact skin. Okay? Lignocaine cannot penetrate intact skin. So suppose this is an intact skin, lignocaine cannot enter. But remember, lignocaine can penetrate abraded skin or damaged skin. It can penetrate abraded skin or damaged skin. Yes, it can penetrate. But intact skin, it cannot penetrate. Okay? It can also penetrate mucous membrane. But where lignocaine cannot penetrate? Lignocaine cannot penetrate at intact skin. Okay? Because of this reason, what we will do, we will give lignocaine and we will add prilocaine to this. We will add prilocaine. So 2.5% of lignocaine is added over to 2.5% of prilocaine. Now this mixture is known as eutectic mixture. This is known as eutectic mixture of local anesthetic, in short form EMLA. Now this eutectic mixture of local anesthetic, remember, it can penetrate intact skin also. Okay, so can we say that lignocaine itself will not able to penetrate intact skin, but when it is mixed with same proportion of prilocaine, it can penetrate. Okay, now what do we mean by the word eutectic mixture? What happens in eutectic mixture? Remember, when we will combine two local anesthetic in eutectic mixture, the melting point of combination becomes less as compared to individual melting point. So what is the definition of eutectic mixture? Eutectic mixture is, if we will mix two drug, their combined melting point becomes less. As the combined melting point becomes less, they will liquefy easily, and as they will liquefy easily, they can easily penetrate intact skin. Okay, so what is the definition of eutectic mixture? Eutectic mixture means the mixture whose melting point is less than the combined melting point. Is there any other eutectic mixture? The answer is yes. There is one more eutectic mixture. Example, we will write lignocaine with tetracaine, and the strength is 7.5%. So these are the two eutectic mixture which can penetrate intact skin. Okay, now let's talk about the uses of lignocaine. Now if you talk about uses of lignocaine, we know lignocaine is a local anesthetic, but let's see, apart from local anesthetic, where lignocaine is also used. So we will write a mnemonic, LENCI. Okay, remember, lignocaine is also an antiarrhythmic drug. It is class 1B antiarrhythmic drug, which is used in the treatment of ventricular fibrillation. Okay. Third, lignocaine is also given in neuropathic pain, like trigeminal neuralgia, etc. It is given as a last resort for the treatment of refractory seizures or epilepsy, known as status epilepticus. As a last resort we give. And lastly, it is given as a last resort for the treatment of intractable cough. So these are the overall uses of lignocaine. Now let's talk about the side effects of lignocaine. Okay. The most common side effect of lignocaine is neurotoxicity. As it is inhibiting peripheral nerves, it causes neurotoxicity. And among neurotoxicity, most common neurotoxic side effect of lignocaine is nystagmus. It can also cause seizures or epilepsy. Now for the treatment of seizures due to lignocaine, the drug of choice for seizures due to lignocaine is diazepam. You give diazepam or benzodiazepine to control. Lignocaine, we know it is acting on heart, so it is also cardiotoxic. In cardiotoxicity, remember, lignocaine causes bradycardia. It can suppress the heart. Lastly, lignocaine can cause a dangerous condition known as malignant hyperthermia. Okay. Now, what is malignant hyperthermia? It's a kind of idiosyncratic reaction. Idiosyncratic means unpredictable reaction. Why it occurs, we don't know. Sometimes what happens, suppose this is a skeletal muscle. Lignocaine causes massive release of calcium. It causes massive release of calcium from smooth endoplasmic reticulum of the calcium muscles, which will cause severe muscle rigidity. You know that calcium is responsible for muscle contraction. It can lead to severe muscle rigidity, and sometimes the muscle can be damaged or muscle degeneration will occur, which is known as rhabdomyolysis, which can also lead to increase in heat production known as hyperthermia. Okay, so this is malignant hyperthermia. Now remember, what are the drugs causes malignant? What is the list of the drugs which causes malignant hyperthermia? The examples of the drug which causes malignant hyperthermia are shell. The first drug you will write is succinylcholine. One general anesthetic agent, halothane, atropine, and lignocaine. Okay. So what is the treatment of this deadly condition? The treatment is rapid cooling. Otherwise, the patient will die. Okay. And we will inhibit the release of calcium from the smooth endoplasmic reticulum. The drug of choice for the treatment of malignant hyperthermia is dantrolene injection. Dantrolene, sodium injection. Now, what is dantrolene? Remember, dantrolene inhibit SER. SER stand for smooth endoplasmic reticulum. Suppose this is a smooth endoplasmic reticulum. And we know it releases calcium. So we will write Sarca channels. Sarca means smooth endoplasmic reticulum calcium channels. Okay. This is also known as ryanodine. It is also known as ryanodine receptor blocker. These channels are also known as ryanodine receptor. It blocks ryanodine receptor. Hence, it inhibits the release of calcium from smooth endoplasmic reticulum. Hence, the muscle will not contract. This rigidity, rhabdomyolysis, and hyperthermia will be reduced. Okay. So, this is all about lignocaine. Now, let's talk about a drug. Next drug, articaine. Okay. Now, articaine, remember, it is used in dental procedures. Okay, as a topical local anesthetic. Third, we will write mepivacaine. Mepivacaine, remember, it is not effective topically. Okay, and remember, it is contraindicated in neonate. And it is contraindicated during labor, child delivery. Remember, it is highly neurotoxic chemical. That is why it is now out of use, rarely used. Prilocaine. Now, prilocaine, remember, it is given topically. It is also given in intravenous regional anesthesia. Now, everywhere drug of choice was lignocaine. Remember, prilocaine is the second drug of choice after lignocaine. After lignocaine, the second drug of choice is prilocaine. Okay. Now, what is the side effect of prilocaine? Now, remember, prilocaine in our body, it gets metabolized. It gets metabolized and form a metabolite known as O-toluidine. O-toluidine. It forms a metabolite in the body by O-toluidine. Now, remember, this O-toluidine, it interacts with vitamin B12. It interacts with vitamin B12 and it produces methemoglobinemia. It produces methemoglobinemia. Because of this reason, this prilocaine causes methemoglobinemia because of a metabolite O-toluidine. And it also causes vitamin B12 deficiency. Okay. Now remember, this prilocaine is absolutely contraindicated in neonates, because in neonates myth hemoglobinemia can develop very easily. Okay, they already have very less amount of antioxidant like G6PD. Because of the lack of antioxidant, myth hemoglobinemia can easily be formed in, it can easily be formed in neonates, and it can also lead to anemia due to vitamin B12 deficiency. Okay, now the next drug we have is etidocaine. Remember, etidocaine is contraindicated during dental surgeries because it causes severe bleeding. Okay, it is also contraindicated intravenously because it is highly cardiotoxic. Okay, now let's talk about the next drug, that is Dubucane. Now, Dubucane overall is the longest and most potent local anesthetic. Okay, it is the longest and the most potent local anesthetic, that is Dubucane. Okay, Dubucane, and it is highly neurotoxic. The side effect will be just like lignocaine, it is highly neurotoxic. Okay, now this Dubucane, apart from used as a local anesthetic, it has one other use. Remember, this Dubucane is metabolized by pseudocholine esterase. It is metabolized by pseudocholine esterase enzyme in the plasma. If this pseudocholine esterase enzyme is atypical, if it is of different type, this Dubucane will not be metabolized. If this pseudocholine esterase is of some atypical type or mutated type, this Dubucane will not be metabolized. This test is known as Dubucane number. So what is Dubucane number? The amount of Dubucane which is generally metabolized by pseudocholine esterase. And in cases of atypical pseudocholine esterase, this Dubucane will not be metabolized. So Dubucane number is a test which is used to assess the activity of atypical pseudocholine esterase. Now remember, atypical pseudocholine esterase also degrades one drug known as succinylcholine. It also degrades succinylcholine. And if atypical pseudocholine esterase is present, remember, it is succinylcholine is absolutely contraindicated in those patients who have atypical form of pseudocholine esterase. So that is why before giving succinylcholine, we do a test known as Dubucane number. Okay, we do a test known as Dubucane number. Now the second last local anesthetic we have is bupivacaine. Now bupivacaine, remember, is a longer acting drug. Not longest, it is longer acting local anesthetic. It is longer acting than lignocaine. Now why it is longer acting than lignocaine? Because it has high affinity for sodium channel. That it binds with sodium channel with high affinity for longer duration of time. Second point, that this bupivacaine has a very special property, that bupivacaine produces more of a sensory block, less of a motor block. It produces more of a sensory block, less of a motor block. Because of this reason, it will not interfere with the muscle contraction. So this bupivacaine is preferred during child delivery. It is preferred during child delivery or labor because it will reduce the pain of labor, but it will not reduce the muscle contraction of uterus. So because of this reason, it is given as an epidural anal anesthetic. It is given as an epidural anesthetic. This block is known as caudal block, which I will be telling you shortly. So in during child delivery, we generally do caudal block. Okay, now let's talk about the side effect of bupivacaine. Now bupivacaine, remember, it causes maximum irritant property, that it causes tissue damage. Okay. Because of this reason, it causes maximum tissue damage. And remember, when bupivacaine is given intravenously, it is highly cardiotoxic. It is highly cardiotoxic. This point you have to remember. That if you will give intravenously bupivacaine, it is highly cardiotoxic. Because of this reason, bupivacaine is absolutely contraindicated in intravenous regional anesthesia. Bupivacaine is absolutely contraindicated in intravenous regional anesthesia. Here the drug of choice in intravenous regional anesthesia was lignocaine or prilocaine. These drugs you give. Lignocaine is the drug of choice. Okay. Now, which cardiotoxicity it generally produces? Let's see the cardiotoxic effect of bupivacaine. It inhibits SA node. Because of this reason, there will be some ECG changes. Remember, it blocks SA node, so there will be increase in RR interval. Okay. It also blocks, we will write, it also inhibits sodium channel on ventricular muscles. Because of this reason, there will be increase in QRS complex. There will be increase in QRS complex. Okay. And increase in QRS complex, remember, will sometimes lead to a fatal arrhythmia known as ventricular fibrillation. Okay. Ventricular fibrillation. Now, let's see what is the treatment of bupivacaine toxicity. Now, the drug of choice for the treatment of bupivacaine toxicity is lipid emulsion. Okay, give lipid emulsion. Remember, lipid emulsion, it will directly neutralize bupivacaine. It will directly neutralize bupivacaine. But if arrhythmias have developed, then you will give antiarrhythmic drug. So overall, the drug of choice for bupivacaine toxicity is lipid emulsion. But if arrhythmia has developed, we will write, if there is bradycardia, then you will give atropine. If there is ventricular fibrillation, you will give amiodarone. Or you can give lignocaine. Okay. So the drug of choice for bupivacaine toxicity is lipid emulsion. That is why we have developed a new drug, that is levoform of bupivacaine, levo enantiomer of bupivacaine. Okay. Now this levoform of bupivacaine, remember, it requires half dose or less doses required. Because of this reason, it is less cardiotoxic. It is less cardiotoxic. Now the last drug we have now is ropivacaine. Now this ropivacaine is a modified form of bupivacaine. Modified, or it is a derivative of bupivacaine. Okay, modified form. Now, like bupivacaine, it also has more of a sensory block as compared to motor block. Because of this reason, they are given during labor as an epidural analgesic, as an epidural anesthetic. Okay. Now, why we have modified this bupivacaine into ropivacaine? The reason is ropivacaine is less cardiotoxic. It is less cardiotoxic. Hence, because of this reason, it can be given as an intravenous regional anesthesia. While bupivacaine is contraindicated in intravenous regional anesthesia. Okay, bupivacaine is contraindicated in intravenous regional anesthesia. Now the last point with ropivacaine is, remember, ropivacaine should not be given in joints. Intra-articular injection of ropivacaine should not be given because it can lead to cartilage damage. It can lead to cartilage damage. Okay, So this is all about the drugs among local anesthetic we have. Okay, so this is all about the drugs we have among local anesthetics. Hello all. So let's discuss now about the techniques and routes of local anesthetics. We have already discussed about the drugs which among local anesthetics. Now let's see how they are given, local anesthetics. So let's start from the beginning. So the first route of giving local anesthetic is topical route. Okay, now topical means it is supplied over the skin and mucous membrane. Okay, so local anesthetics, remember, they are applied over the skin or mucous membrane. They can be applied in various formulations like ointment. It can be applied as solution, jellies, okay, jellies, suppositories, etc. Okay, suppositories. Now, the drawback of giving topical or skin, when it is applied skin, remember, in the submucous part, there is sensory nerves. In submucosal part of the skin, there is sensory nerves. So these are the sensory nerves which are present in the submucosa. Remember, when local anesthetic is applied on the surface of the skin, it cannot act on submucosal sensory nerves. Because of this reason, topical application of local anesthetic cannot provide pain relief. There is no pain relief on topical application of local anesthetics. Now, one topical surface is a part of topical application is ocular application of local anesthetics. Now, ocular application, that means it is applied in eyes over the cornea. Now remember, in cornea we have trigeminal nerves which carry pain sensation. So ocular application of local anesthetic is done during eye surgeries. Now during eye surgeries, the local anesthetics which are given are tetracaine. Okay. Second is proparacaine. And lastly, binoxinate. Now this binoxinate, remember, it doesn't interfere with intraocular pressure. Because of this reason, it is the drug of choice of application of local anesthetics during tonometry. Tonometry means when we measure the intraocular tension of eye. IOT is intraocular tension, and it is given for the, it is done for the diagnosis of glaucoma. Now just remember one point, that there was a local anesthetic, the first local anesthetic which we made was cocaine. Now cocaine is only given as an ocular LA. It is never given injection because of its addictive potential. But the point with cocaine is that cocaine, it produces midriasis. When it is given as a topical ocular anesthetic, the reason is it has a sympathomimetic activity. It causes sympathetic discharge, and sympathetic activity produces dilatation of pupil, which is known as midriasis. And it can also cause damage to the cornea. So that is why nowadays we very less prefer to use cocaine. So it causes corneal damage, or you can write corneal sloughing or corneal damage. Now let's talk about the second route of local anesthetic application, that is known as infiltrative. Okay, infiltrative. Now in infiltrative, what we will be doing, we will give an injection of local anesthetic into deeper tissue. Okay. And among them, remember, the drug of choice is amide containing local anesthetics, which are better than ester containing local anesthetic. The reason is they have longer acting, they produce less allergic reaction, and they can provide more pain relief, better pain relief as compared to ester containing local anesthetics. So the drugs are, we can write, the drugs among amide containing are lignocaine, bupivacaine, and the longest acting dubucaine. Okay, so lignocaine, remember, is a short acting, bupivacaine is a intermediate acting, and dubucaine overall is the longest acting local anesthetic agent. You can also give certain ester containing like procaine and tetracaine. Okay, now the third route of administration we will write. So this infiltrative is generally given in minor surgeries. What is the use of infiltrative local anesthetic? It is given in minor surgeries. Example, hydrocele surgery. Okay, hydrocele surgery. Okay, now the third route of local anesthetic application is known as field block. Okay, in field block we give subcutaneous injection of local anesthetic. Okay, so we give subcutaneous injection. Okay, and we know that there are various nerve supply in subcutaneous injection. So because of this reason, it will block all types of nerve supply, all type of nerve supply in an organ distal to it. Okay, and it also requires lesser dose. Now the fourth type of injection is known as tumescent anesthetic. Now tumescent anesthetic is again subcutaneous injection in very large dose. In such a large dose that it will cause swelling of subcutaneous tissue. Because of this reason, you can now easily remove this subcutaneous fat. So now you can easily dissect or remove subcutaneous fat. Hence, tumescent anesthetic is used for the treatment of known as liposuction or fat removal. Tumescent local anesthetic is given in treatment in removal of fat, known as lipo means fat, suction means removal. Now the fifth type of local anesthetic is known as nerve block. Okay, remember, nerve block is also known as field block. It is also known as field block because we are giving injection directly into a deeper tissue. Now in cases of nerve block, remember, local anesthetic is injected around a peripheral nerve. Okay, around a peripheral nerve or the bunch of peripheral nerve known as plexus. Plexus means bunch of peripheral nerves. Okay, remember, it is around. It is never inside the nerve. It is never into the nerve. It is around the nerve. Okay, it is never into the nerve, because if you will insert local anesthetic into the nerve, it will cause nerve damage, and nerve damage will cause increase in pain. So it is always around the nerve. Okay, now as you are giving, it is around a nerve or a plexus, can we say it will decrease sensory nerve supply? It can reduce motor nerve supply. Hence, motor nerve supply can lead to skeletal muscle relaxation. And can we say that there are also autonomic nerves which maintains our blood pressure and vital organs? So sometimes it can also lead to hypotension due to blockage of autonomic nerves. So all these nerves are blocked when it is injected around a bunch of nerve or a plexus. Okay, now the drugs which we use among nerve block is either lignocaine produces action for less than 2 hours, or you can use bupivacaine. Remember, bupivacaine is longer acting. It will produce effect for more than 2 hours. Okay, Now, depending upon the plexus we are using, let's see the different types of nerve block. So the first nerve block we will write is brachial plexus block. Okay, brachial plexus block. So suppose this is a human. Okay, so in brachial plexus block, we inject the drug around brachial plexus. And where it is done? It is given in the area of shoulder or arm. Hence, it is given for the surgeries of shoulder and arm. Okay. Now, what is the side effect? The side effect is sometimes the pleura of the lung becomes damaged. So, the side effect of brachial plexus block is pneumothorax. The air may be collected in pleura between the two pleuras of the lung. So, the side effect of brachial plexus block comes out to be pneumothorax. Now, the second block we will write, it is intercostal block. In intercostal block, we inject the local anesthetic in intercostal nerves. Okay. Now, intercostal block is done for the surgeries of thorax and upper abdomen. Suppose this is umbilicus. For the surgeries of thorax and upper abdomen. Now, what is the side effect? Again, the pleura of the lungs will get damaged. It can lead to pneumothorax. Okay. Now, the third one we will write is cervical block. The cervical area means this neck area. So, we block cervical sympathetic ganglia and it is done for the surgeries of neck. Fourth, we will write sciatic block. Sciatic nerve block or sometimes femoral nerve block. Okay. And it is done for the surgeries of knee. Knee surgery or below the knee surgery. Okay. So, knee surgeries. Next, we will write. So, sciatic nerve block is done around here for the knee surgery. Then we will write pudendal nerve block. Now, pudendal nerve block, remember, is given for the surgeries of perineum. Like perineum surgery and during perineal block, we can also do forceps delivery. So, in forceps delivery, we do pudendal block. Okay. We can also do episiotomy. Episiotomy means it is an incision into the vagina, labia majora, for creating a roomier space for the delivery of a child. And lastly, we will write celiac plexus block. Now, celiac plexus, remember, it supplies the GIT organs, GIT visceras. So, it is given for the surgeries of abdominal visceral organ like stomach, intestine, spleen, etc. The side effect is, as we know, that these nerves are autonomic nerves. Because of inhibition of these nerves, it can lead to diarrhea and hypotension. Okay. So, celiac plexus block can lead to diarrhea and hypotension. Okay. So, this is about nerve block. Now, the next type of giving technique we will give, we will write is, that is intravenous regional anesthesia. So, after nerve block, the next one is intravenous regional anesthesia, which is also in short form known as IVRA. Okay. Now, intravenous regional anesthesia, remember, is also known as Beer's block. Now, what do we do in Beer's block? It is done generally in cases of limbs. Okay. Now, let's see. Suppose this is a limb. Okay. This is, let's say, upper limb. And these are the fingers. Okay. Now what we will be doing in Beer's block, we will tie a tourniquet. Tourniquet we will tie. And we will inflate tourniquet to increase the pressure. We increase the pressure. Now how much pressure should be increased? It should be more than 100 to 150 millimeter of mercury above the normal systolic pressure. So what is the normal systolic BP of the patient? Increase the pressure of tourniquet more than 100 to 150 above the normal pressure. Now as you have inflated this tourniquet, the first part, now in a vein we will inject intravenous local anesthetic. We will inject intravenous local anesthetic. Because of this high pressure, this local anesthetic will not able to move into the upper limb, into the distal part, or sorry, the proximal part towards the heart. So it will produce anesthesia in this, the lower part, the part of the limb which is below the tourniquet. So it will produce anesthesia below the tourniquet. Okay. Now what we'll be doing, we will, after this injection of this local anesthetic, now we will deflate and remove tourniquet. Okay. And the effect of local anesthetic will last for, effect will last for, after removal, for last for 10 to 15 minutes. Okay. So after removal of tourniquet, the effect, till the tourniquet is there, the effect will be there. And after the removal of tourniquet, the effect will last for 10 to 15 minutes. Now, what is the use of this Beer's block? Beer's block is given for limb surgeries. Okay. In limb surgeries. And suppose we have to give a drug in limb. Okay. Second, it is also given for orthopedic procedures of limb. Orthopedic procedures of limb. So that the pain should not occur. Okay. Now, which is the drug of choice in IVRA, intravenous regional anesthesia? The drug of choice among intravenous regional anesthesia is lignocaine. Is lignocaine. Okay. Lignocaine. How much lignocaine we give? Generally 5% we give. It is the drug of choice, but you can also give. You can also give prilocaine. This is the second choice of the drug. You can also give ropivacaine. Okay. But remember, there are certain drugs which are absolutely contraindicated IV. There are certain drugs which should never be given in intravenously, that is bupivacaine. Bupivacaine is never given IV, and second is etidocaine. The reason is small amount of bupivacaine IV and etidocaine IV are highly cardiotoxic. They can go to the heart and they can produce fatal arrhythmias. So because of this reason, in intravenous regional anesthesia, bupivacaine and etidocaine are absolutely contraindicated. They are highly cardiotoxic drugs. Okay. Now, the next type of anesthesia we will write is spinal anesthesia. Okay. Spinal anesthesia. Now, spinal anesthesia means we will inject local anesthetic into subarachnoid space. Subarachnoid space. Remember, subarachnoid space contains cerebrospinal fluid, and subarachnoid space is between. It is between arachnoid matter and pia mater. Okay, it is between arachnoid matter and pia mater. Now, the point is, you must remember that it is given in the spinal cord. Suppose this is a spinal cord, and around this there is vertebral column, and in vertebral column we have various spaces. So we inject this drug into CSF. So I'll show you a diagram where the CSF lies. Now remember one point, okay, that this CSF can move upwards also. So the problem with spinal anesthesia is that this drug, through CSF, as CSF can move anti-gravity, it can reach into brain. Okay. So how we can avoid this complication? We will see that we will make this local anesthetic very heavy. Very heavy if we will make, it will settle down. So that is known as hyperbaric local anesthetics. So first let's see what is the method of giving injection into CSF method. Now remember, spinal anesthetic agents in adults, they are given at the level of L4 to L5, lumbar vertebra, between L4 and L5. And in child, they are given between L3 to L4. Okay. Now, when you are giving an injection of a local anesthetic, which structures do you pierce to reach into CSF subarachnoid space? So let's see the structure pierced. Okay. Structure pierced when you are giving an injection of spinal anesthesia. So let's see what are the structures which can be pierced. So if you think about what are the structures which comprise of from a surface to below, let's see what are the structures we have. Okay, let's see what are the structures. Okay, so let's see what are the structures. So let's see what are the structures which are pierced when we are giving spinal anesthesia. Okay, so let's see the structure from the surface to the deeper part. Okay, as you can see, from right to left, there is a skin in the rightest portion. Then below the skin, there is subcutaneous tissue. And below the subcutaneous tissue, you can see the first ligament, that is supraspinous ligament, written out here. Okay. Now below this supraspinous ligament, you are seeing there is some interspinous ligament out there. So supraspinous is above this vertebra. So these are the vertebras, and above this vertebra on the right side, we have supraspinous. Between this vertebra, we have interspinous ligament, and behind this vertebra, we have ligamentum flavum. Okay, ligamentum flavum. Now beneath this ligamentum flavum, we have dura mater, and in dura mater, we have epidural space. Okay, and below this epidural space, we have, this is the dura. Below this dura mater or epidural space, we have arachnoid mater, which is known as subarachnoid septum with subarachnoid space. Okay, arachnoid membrane with subarachnoid space. So we will draw this diagram. So suppose you are giving an injection. The first structure you have to pierce is skin. By a needle, you have to pierce a skin. Now beneath skin, there is subcutaneous fat. So the second structure you have to pierce is subcutaneous fat. Okay. Now beneath subcutaneous fat, remember these are the vertebra. These are the vertebra. And beneath this vertebra, we have a spinal cord. Okay. Now above this vertebra, we have before this vertebra, we have supraspinous ligament. Supraspinous ligament. The function of this supraspinous ligament is to connect the two spines of vertebra. Suppose these are the two spines of vertebra. These two spines of vertebra are connected together by supraspinous ligament. Okay. Now beneath this supraspinous ligament, the next structure is interspinous ligament. Okay, interspinous ligament. Okay, so this is supraspinous, this is interspinous. Now beneath this interspinous ligament, where the spine ends, we have ligamentum flavum. Okay, ligamentum flavum. Now beneath this ligamentum flavum, we have a layer known as, so this was ligamentum flavum. Then we have dura mater. Then we have dura mater. So beneath ligamentum flavum, we have dura mater. Now you have to remember one point, that this space between ligamentum flavum and dura mater, this space between ligamentum flavum and dura mater is known as epidural space. Okay. So we will write that this space is epidural space. Okay, then beneath dura mater, we will write we have arachnoid mater. arachnoid meter. Okay, the third layer, and this is arachnoid matter. And then we have pia mater, which is attached to spinal cord. Pia. Now beneath, between this pia mater and arachnoid matter, we have a space known as subarachnoid space. Okay, so between this arachnoid mater and pia mater, we have a space known as subarachnoid space, which contains CSF, cerebrospinal fluid, subarachnoid space. Now you have to remember that spinal anesthesia is given in subarachnoid space. So spinal anesthesia is given between subarachnoid space, that is between arachnoid matter and dura mater. Okay. Now, if we talk about, there is a technique which we will be discussing, that is epidural anesthetics. Remember, epidural anesthesia is given between ligamentum flavum and dura mater. Epidural anesthesia is given between ligamentum flavum and dura mater. Spinal anesthesia is given between arachnoid matter and pia mater. Okay. Now, which needle generally we use? Okay. Which needle we use for giving spinal anesthesia? Okay. Now, remember, there are two types of needles or spinal needles. There are two types of spinal needles we have. Now, these two types of spinal needle, either they are known as dura cutting. They will cut this meningeal membrane. Or we have dura separating. They will not cut it. Dura separating. Okay. Now, dura cutting, the spinal needle we have is known as, we will write Quinque needle. Quinque needle. The full form is Quinque Bebock needle. So it will pierce dura. Remember, it will pierce or tear dura. It will tear dura. While in dura separating, it will not tear. Not tear. The needles we have among dura separating are two. Either we have Vitake needle or we have Sprotte needle. Sprotte needle. Okay. So these are the various spinal needles we use. Okay. Now let's talk about what is the shape of Quinque needles. If you talk about the shape of Quinque needle, the shape of the Quinque needle is the bevel end is just like this. This is the bevel end. And if you rotate it, it will be just like this. And there is sharpness out here. So I'll show you the diagram shortly. So it will cut, this part will cut through it. Okay. Now, what about Vitake? If you talk about Vitake, the needle bevel, there the hole in the needle through which we will be giving the drug, is not at a bevel end. Okay, it is just like this. Okay. And if you will rotate it, the shape will become just like this. So this is the hole in the black through which local anesthetic is delivered. So it will not cut through the dura. While Sprotte, it is more of a circular path. It is more of a circular. Okay. So if you see the shape, it will be circular or round. So Sprotte. Okay. So I'll show you the diagram of these needles. Okay. So the diagram of these needles is, you can see on the right side, this is Quinque needle. You are seeing the Quinque needle, the bevel end is cut. The tip of the Quinque needle is already cut. In Vitake and Sprotte, you are seeing the tip is not cutting. There is a hole beneath the tip of the needle, okay, through which they will not cut the dura, they will just separate them. Okay, so these are the needles among Quinque, Vitake and Sprotte. Now what is the problem with Quinque needle? The main side effect of Quinque needle is that this Quinque needle, remember, it causes CSF leak. Because of dura mater damage, it causes CSF leak. Okay, they will cause least or no CSF leak. Okay, the problem with Quinque needle is it causes leakage of CSF. And why leakage of CSF? Due to trauma. So So that is why sometimes Quinquay needle is also known as traumatic needle. While these two needles are atraumatic needle. Okay, atraumatic needle. Now remember CSF leakage, remember it causes a side effect known as headache. Leakage of CSF causes headache. Okay, due to sudden reduction in pressure of CSF. Okay, so remember this part. Now let's see what are the complications of doing spinal anesthesia. What is the complications or the drawbacks of giving spinal anesthetics or the side effect? Now the most common side effect of giving spinal anesthesia, the patient suffers from hypotension. Okay, and remember hypotension is the most common side effect which is developed intraoperatively. When you are doing this procedure, the patient can go into hypotension. Now what is the cause of hypotension during spinal anesthesia? The cause of hypotension is there is decrease in sympathetic discharge because you are blocking sympathetic nerve, and decrease in sympathetic discharge causes venodilation, and venodilation will lead to hypotension. Okay, hypotension. Now how to treat this hypotension? Remember, put the patient head down position so that the blood supply to the brain should remain patent. So the blood supply to the brain will keep on going. So we put the patient on head down position. Okay, and this position, if a patient develops hypotension, put the head of the patient down. This position is known as Trendelenburg position. This is known as Trendelenburg position. Okay, so remember this part. And if you want to treat this hypotension, the drug of choice is to increase BP by giving vasopressors. Increase the BP by giving vasopressor, and the drug of choice is ephedrine. Ephedrine is a sympathomimetic drug which will increase the BP. Okay, you can also give phenylephrine, but drug of choice is ephedrine. You can also give phenylephrine. They are sympathomimetic drug. They will increase sympathetic discharge. Okay, now the second side effect of drawback of using spinal anesthesia is that they cause headache. They may cause headache. Now remember, headache is the most common side effect of spinal anesthesia which is seen post-operatively. It is mainly seen. Maximum incidence of headache occurs within 2 days, before 2 days. And remember, it spontaneously get reduced or resolved. This headache can spontaneously resolve within 7 days. Within 7 days, it spontaneously resolve. Okay. Now, what is the best treatment of this headache? If a patient develops headache, what is the best treatment? The best treatment of treating this headache due to spinal anesthesia is give a patch of autologous blood patch. Apply a blood patch to that area of that same person. Autologous blood patch. Okay. Autologous blood patch. It is generally applied after 1 day. You can also treat this headache by giving caffeine. Caffeine reduces headache. Or you can give sumatriptan. Sumatriptan is a anti-migraine drug. But remember, the best treatment is giving autologous blood patch. Okay, now autologous blood patch. And how you can prevent this headache? You can prevent this headache by using atraumatic needle. Atraumatic and small bore needle. Because we have already discussed that headache occurs due to CSF leak. And atraumatic and small bore needle will not cause, or less chance of CSF leak will occur. Because of this reason, try to use an atraumatic needle, which we have already discussed. That was Vitake and Sprotte needle. Okay, Vitake and Sprotte needle. Now, what are the other rare side effects we can write? Other rare side effects is injection site infections. It can also lead to bradycardia. Now, why bradycardia occurs? Now, bradycardia occurs due to blockage of T1 to T4 nerves. Because this CSF can move upwards anti-gravity and it can block the nerves of T1 to T4. T1 to T4, remembers, are the sympathetic nerves to the heart. And if they are blocked, it can lead to bradycardia. Okay? It can lead to bradycardia. There are other reasons for bradycardia after spinal anesthesia also. It is also due to reverse brain bridge reflex. Reverse brain bridge reflex. Now, what is this reverse brain bridge reflex? Remember, as we know that there is decrease in sympathetic activity. Decrease in sympathetic activity causes venodilation. Because of this reason, less amount of the blood will come to the atria. Hence, there will be decrease in atrial stretch. Because the less amount of the blood will come to the atria. Now, remember, decrease in atrial stretch stimulate vagus nerve. And this vagus nerve, remember, causes bradycardia. It causes bradycardia. And there is one more reason of bradycardia. The main reason for bradycardia is blockage of T1 to T4 nerves. But there is one more reflex known as Bizzold Zariszk reflex. Okay. It is also known as coronary chemoreflex. Okay. Now, why it occurs? We know that due to trauma to spinal cord, there is release of inflammatory mediators like serotonin, etc. These inflammatory mediators, remember, or noxious mediators due to trauma to the spinal cord, remember, they carry a reflex which can directly stimulate vagus nerve. And vagus nerve can lead to suppression of heart rate. Now, the last point where the spinal anesthesia side effect is, it may cause cauda equina syndrome or cauda equine syndrome. Now, cauda equine syndrome occurs because the last roots of spinal cord, which is just like a horse tail, if we give a spinal anesthetic agent, it can block the caudal nerves in the spinal cord. Now, remember, these caudal nerves, they supply bladder and they supply bowel. And the sphincters of the bladder and bowel are controlled by caudal nerves. So, it will cause bladder sphincter loss or uncontrolled, or bowel sphincter loss. So, because of this reason, a patient will pass out urine and pass out feces. The control of bladder and bowel are lost because of the blockage of caudal nerves. Okay? Because of the blockage of caudal nerves. Okay? So, these are the drawbacks of using spinal anesthetics. Now, let's see what are the drugs we use among spinal anesthetics. The drugs among spinal anesthetics we use is lignocaine. Okay. Lignocaine, remember, is given for short acting. It's a short acting drug for small procedures. You can give bupivacaine in spinal anesthesia. You can also give tetracaine. Now, bupivacaine, tetracaine, remember, they are intermediate acting. And lastly, you can also give dubucaine. Dubucaine, we have already discussed, it is the longest acting drug. So, these are the drugs we have. Now, there is a point out here which we have to remember, that when we are giving a drug into CSF, we know that CSF can move upwards anti-gravity also. So, this drug can move upwards and it can damage, it can block the nerves in upper segment of spinal cord. Hence, we will make this drug or local anesthetic heavy. If we will make it heavy, it will settle downwards, it will not move upwards. So, how to make this drug heavy? We can make this local anesthetic heavy by increasing its pressure. These kinds of drug are known as hyperbaric. Baric means pressure. Hyperbaric solution of local anesthetics. So, in spinal anesthesia, we generally give hyperbaric solution. Because of this reason, they settle downwards. Settle downwards or distally. Okay. Now, how we can make a solution of local anesthetic hyperbaric? By adding 7.5% glucose. We add 7.5% glucose and make this make this solution heavy. Okay, so if we ask about that, if we are giving hyperbaric solution, hyperbaric means the density of this solution is less than CSF, the density or the pressure is less than CSF, you can say it can move upwards. And if it can move upwards, don't you think that it can block the upper nerves? Hence it is not used. Hence it is not used. Okay, so remember this part. Now, what is the position of giving spinal anesthesia? The position is, the patient is generally left or right lateral position. Okay, left or right lateral position. So the patient, knees are towards the chest and head is towards the knees, and the patient is on the lateral side. Okay, now the next point is, what are the contraindications of giving spinal anesthesias? What is the contraindication? Remember, spinal anesthesia is contraindicated in some spine structural abnormality or spine ka structure defect. Suppose the patient is having kyphosis, scoliosis. We never give spinal anesthetic agent to that patient. We will write children. In children, we don't give spinal anesthesia. Sepsis or infection, it can lead to meningitis. Increase in intracranial tension, it can lead to more CSF leak. And lastly, if a patient has low platelet count, generally less than 80,000, because it will increase the risk of bleeding. So these are the contraindications of giving spinal anesthesia. Okay, these are the contraindications of giving spinal anesthesia. Now, last anesthesia we will talk about is epidural anesthesia. Okay, so in epidural anesthesia, we give an injection in epidural space. We inject a drug in epidural space. And if you recall that part, epidural space was between. Epidural space was between ligamentum flavum and dura mater. It was between ligamentum flavum and dura mater. Okay, now which needle we use during epidural anesthesia? The needle we use in epidural anesthesia is known as Tehoe's needle. Okay, so here the needle name is Tehoe's needle. In epidural anesthesia, we use Tehoe's needle. Now, what is the shape of Tehoe's needle? It's a very thin needle, and this thin needle has a curvature in the front of it, like this Tehoe's needle. So I'll show you the needle shape. Now, what is the shape of that needle? So Tehoe's needle is just like this. So as you can see, this is the needle, and you can see the tip of the needle is a little bit curved from the upwards. So if you can see in more detailed word, this is Tehoe's needle. Okay, and how it is given? So this is how Tehoe's needle is given. Okay, so it is curved from the tip. Okay, curved from the tip. Okay, now remember, epidural anesthesia is more difficult to give. It is more difficult to give as compared to spinal anesthesia. The reason is, we can assure that we can easily find out subarachnoid space. It is very easy to identify subarachnoid space. The reason is, when you pierce dura, there is loss of resistance. There is sudden loss of resistance. Because of sudden loss of resistance, we come to assure that our needle is in CSF. So there is sudden loss of resistance, and you can become very sure that your needle is in CSF because of sudden loss of resistance after piercing the dura. But in cases of epidural, there is no such landmark or such kind of a sign by which we can see that epidural space has been, we have went to an epidural space. So we don't have any hint that epidural space have been reached or not. So in spinal anesthesia, we get a very good hint that there is sudden loss of resistance when needle pierces dura and comes into CSF. While there is no such sign which we find, an anesthetic will find in cases of epidural anesthetics. Now let's see what are the drugs we use in epidural anesthesia. So we give chlorpromazine. Chlorpromazine, remember, is the overall shortest acting LA. Okay, then we give lignocaine. Lignocaine is short. Okay, lastly we give bupivacaine and etidocaine. Bupivacaine and etidocaine are long acting drugs. Okay, long as compared to lignocaine, they are long acting. So remember, epidural anesthesia is technically more difficult. So what are the drawbacks of epidural anesthesia? Remember, you will write it is technically more difficult as compared to spinal anesthesia. Second, remember, in this epidural space, above this epidural space, remember, there are epidural veins. And because of this reason, a drug may get systemically absorbed. Drug gets absorbed into the blood easily because of the presence of epidural plexus of veins. Hence, there is more toxicity of a drug when it will come into the blood. Okay, so epidural is technically more difficult and it is more toxic. The drug will have more toxic effect. Okay, now let's see what is the level and which is the site at which we give. Level or site of epidural anesthesia. Okay, now epidural anesthesia can be given in three sites. You will write thoracic, second lumbar, and lastly caudal. And it is known as thoracic block, lumbar block, and caudal block. Now, thoracic block is given in mid-thoracic segment. Okay, and it is given for the surgeries of thorax and upper abdomen. Thorax and upper abdomen. Okay, in lumbar block, we generally give L2 to L3 or we give L4 to L5 epidural injection. So, it is given for the surgeries of lower abdomen. Lower abdomen, it is given for the surgeries of pelvis, it is given for the surgeries of hind limbs. Okay, and remember, this lumbar space is the narrowest space, it requires least amount of drug, least amount of local anesthetic is required in cases of lumbar block. Now if you talk about caudal block is given in sacral canal. Okay, and remember, sacral canal is a very big space. We have to give maximum amount of a drug. Maximum amount of local anesthetic is given in caudal block. Okay, now caudal block is generally given for the surgeries like pelvic surgery, perineum surgery, genital surgery, bladder surgery, and during vaginal delivery. Okay, vaginal delivery, you can write like forceps delivery and during episiotomy. Okay, so it is given in these cases. So these are the blocks of epidural injection: thoracic, lumbar, and caudal block. Okay, so this is all about the roots of local anesthetics. So we completed with local anesthetics. Thank you very much.